And I saw that video and it just reminded me of myself. I knew for years God was calling my name. It just felt like that I was sinking deeper and deeper sometimes. But I just wasn't willing to be in His will. I just wasn't, I still wanted to try to do things in my life on my own. And as that verse said, He said, I wasn't ready, but He kept letting me sink until my heart would change. So I saw that, and it just reminded me of myself. And I was thinking, maybe other people are going through some difficult times, and even sometimes prosperity. Prosperity keeps us coming from God because everything looks good. You know, we have our health, we have our wealth, we have all these other things, and everything looks good on the outside, and we're just passing through life, and you just know there's this empty spot on you, and you don't know what it is. And from the outside, you think your life should be great, and on the inside, you're just tore up. And for other of us, there's all kinds of problems and burdens in our lives. So once again, I just want to take the time to invite everybody here, and I do pray that the Lord will mightily touch your lives, that He'll touch your whole family, and He'll touch you in every kind of way that's possibly imaginable. Touch your finances, touch your health, touch your children, touch all these things. But maybe if you're going through some difficult times, I want to remind you that the pendulum always swings the other way. You know, when you're in very difficult times, we have to remember to trust God that sooner or later that pendulum is going to come up here and things are going to be great again. But we're in that great period, we also have to remember the pendulum swings the other way. So enjoy them and praise God for them. And don't lose your relationship with Him, because you know that it's going to swing the other way. There'll be times, you know, as we get older, maybe things change. When you're younger, your difficulties are different. As I get older, I see my mom failing. I saw my dad pass away. I saw my grandparents pass away. And what I thought was difficulty really wasn't difficulty when I was younger. God just sort of expands our horizon. And one of the other things, you know, I do want to thank we have an online audience. It's growing all the time. We've been really blessed. In fact, our online audience is bigger than our audience here today. And that's a good thing in a way. We're missing some of our regular people. My daughter took Callie on vacation, and some of our regular people are taking some vacations right before the winter starts. So I just want to tell everybody how much I appreciate you being here today, especially some people I haven't seen for a while that I just love dearly, love their family dearly. So we just want you to feel at home. We just want you to know that this is a place that's safe, that this is a place that I hope you feel the love of God, and this is a place where you're going to meet people just like you, no matter where you're at. And it's hard for me to believe, but you know, we're getting ready to go into Thanksgiving, Christmas. 1 week, 1 month from tomorrow is Thanksgiving Day, the 26th, falls on 26th this year, and 2 months from today is Christmas Day. And that's just hard for me to believe, I'm not prepared. You know, I love Christmas. I love the idea of Christmas. I love what Christmas stands for. You know, Christ is in Christmas. There's a reason they're called Christmas. But when it comes to all the hoopla and all the things that come along, I'm not sure if I'm completely ready for all that yet. And then a lot of us don't realize it, but then next week is what they call Fallback Day. And it's called Fallback Day because we set the clocks back an hour. We fall back, and I'm not sure if I'm ready for that. So I just want to remind you all, before you go to bed on Saturday night, to set your clocks back an hour. And if you're constantly have friends that are maybe late for church and things like that, don't tell them. And maybe they'll be on church, you know, time for church next week. I don't know. But, you know, for a lot of us, you know, at this time of year, I think it's a great day to remember we need to sometimes fall back into the arms of Jesus and just accept His rest. You know, and for some of us that live very hectic lives, you maybe have children or grandchildren or businesses to run, that just the idea of having rest, just the idea of not being tired, might seem heavenly to you. And I know, you know, I know what it's like to be tired. I mean, there was a time in my life, I was much younger, I was so tired, I was burning a candle at both ends. I was so tired on the way home that I actually began to hallucinate. It was early in the morning, and I was actually going, and I praise God for protecting fools sometimes. I really do. I was so tired. I'd been up. I hadn't slept in about a week, and I drove a great big cola truck. So I'm driving a vehicle, 26-ton vehicle loaded with sodas, and I hadn't slept in a week. But on my way home to get dressed to go to work to drive the vehicle, the shadows in the road began to look like people. I'll never forget it. In Mark, in the Gospel of Mark, Mark records a blind man said, you know, I see people and they look like trees walking around. Well, I saw trees that looked like people walking around. It was the opposite. And that's tired. But you know, there's a difference between being tired and being weary. You know, tired is just physical exhaustion. You've exerted yourself to the point that you're just tired. But you know, weary sometimes comes from the pressures of the world, your problems, your family, that comes from others. You know, all this stuff gets placed on your shoulders and you just become weary. I think about that, you know, and again, you know, I want you to know something. When I was talking about going home and driving, there were no chemicals in my body or anything like that. It was just pure exhaustion. Now, lack of sleep, I don't think always makes us weary. But even when you're weary, you can get a lot of sleep and still be weary. You know, when the problems of the world weigh your shoulders down, you can get plenty of sleep and still wake up tired. You can still go to sleep and wake up after 8, 9, 10 hours and get up and feel like that weight is still upon you, that you're still weary. I think being overly tired allows the adversary, allows the problems of life to help make us grow weary faster. But just because you're tired doesn't mean you're weary. There was a point in my life when I lived with virtually no sleep, but I can honestly say I wasn't weary. I was exhausted, but I wasn't weary. Now, to illustrate this, I'm going to ask for a voluntold. Now, I would use the term volunteer, but when you tell Bryce to come up and you just don't ask him, it's more of a voluntold than a volunteer, you know? So I'm going to ask Bryce to come up and give me a hand with this illustration. I'm going to try to illustrate what I'm going to talk about today. So, Bryce, I need you up here for just a little while, and hopefully you'll be a good sport about this. I'm not going to shock you hard. No, I'm just kidding. Come up here and let's take a look at this glass. You can stand right here and tell me how much you think that glass weighs.
I'd say maybe between 1 to 2 pounds.
Okay, is it heavy?
No.
All right, can you hold it like that? All right, now just hold it right there until I tell you to stop. Now, as Bryce is holding that cup, I just want to tell you about one of my favorite stories in the Bible. It's an account that a lot of people don't know about. It's called, if I can get my clicker to work, which is not working. Brianna, can you go back and touch the space bar on the thing, please? It's called the Bent Over Woman. Now, it's an account that's in the Gospel of Luke. Did you switch hands?
Yeah.
Did you switch hands?
Yeah.
I missed that. It's an account in the Bible called the book the Bent Over Woman. And in this account, it's not in the Gospel of Luke. This lady is in a crowd, and Jesus is preaching. Now, what we know from other accounts is that Jesus is preaching. At this point in time in his ministry, there were probably a lot of people in the crowd. He was starting to attract a lot of people, and he was starting to attract some negative publicity as well. The Sadducees and Pharisees, which were the religious people at the time, they'd come when Jesus was speaking, but they weren't there to hear his message. He was there. They were there to criticize. And some of us have been in churches where we know what that's all about, don't we? But they weren't there to hear the message. They were there to criticize. But most of the crowd was there because Jesus had really gone along and was speaking something new. He was speaking about God's love and God's grace, and it wasn't about the law anymore. And people were finding this relief, and they were just gathering around him. Well, as he's speaking, out of his eye, he sort of catches this bent-over lady in the crowd. And he calls her forward. Now, this lady at this point in time, she has to make a decision, because if you're bent over like this, the Bible says not only was she bent over, she was bent over double, much like this woman right here. And not only was she bent over double, she'd been that way for a long, long time. According to the scripture, she'd been that way for 18 years. Now, just try to picture if a woman like this walked into our place. But wouldn't she sort of attract attention? Wouldn't you just look at her? Even good, meaning great people of God would look at her and just wonder. Someone would have sympathy, you know, some people would probably ridicule her, all this stuff. And Jesus called her out. So now she is the center of attention. You can imagine a whole crowd looks at her. And she has to make a decision. Am I just going to stay here where it's safe and it's comfortable? Am I going to go out the back door and never know what Jesus wants? And I imagine, you know, she's in the crowd. She's heard the stories about Jesus. She's heard the miracles. She's heard the thing. How are you making out, buddy? Okay, just a second. Can you switch hands again? Okay, I missed it. If you did, I missed it. I missed it the first time, too. Just want to make sure you're okay. Would she go forward? You know, she has to sort of make a decision. Would she go forward? Because if she goes forward, she doesn't really know what Jesus wants. She knows he might want something. She's probably heard the stories of the miracles. She's probably even heard the story that Jesus has raised a couple people from the dead. We remember Lazarus, but we don't remember the other ones. He raised at least 3 or 4 people from the dead. So she'd probably hear that. What, will he heal me today? But it's the Sabbath day. Well, Jesus, if Jesus is really who he says he is, and he's telling us now that he is God incarnate, that he is God in a body, he is God in the flesh, that he is, you want to kneel right here and maybe rest for a little while? put it down. Would he act? I just said, don't put it down. Hold it up. You're cheating. But anyway, but you know, would he really heal on the Sabbath if he was God? Or would he, if he did heal her, would the crowd be mad because it was a Sabbath? Would the Pharisees and the Sadducees turn against her and sort of make her the point of their anger? Would her life become more miserable than it always was? I mean, it was a Sabbath day, which was a Saturday at that period of time. They were, not only was it a Sabbath day, they were in the church at the time. They were in the synagogue. And Jesus calls her forward. Now, can you imagine that was you? You know, what do you do? I mean, how many times have you been in a church service where you knew you should come up and you didn't do it? So if she didn't come up, we couldn't blame her for not coming up because we've all done the same thing. Sweating? Yeah. Okay, just checking. Looks like it's getting heavy. I'm not sure. But you said it wasn't heavy, so I'm good. She takes a chance. She makes a decision that she's going to go forward. And when she does, Jesus performs a miracle. The Bible says that he spoke to her, and then he touched her, and immediately she stood up. Immediately she experienced the miracle of Jesus, but she could have never experienced it if she wasn't obedient to his call. Now, I think this picture is a physical picture of spiritual truth, is what I think this is. Right? The physical picture is a bent over lady. And you can imagine, this lady's been on there, she's probably in a lot of pain. She's probably somewhat embarrassed about her condition. It's probably difficult for her to do daily chores. Most people couldn't, because all she can see is the ground. It's hard for her to look up. I would imagine her problem, her handicap, her disease, whatever it was a burden to her. Now, that's the physical picture that I see. This is what I see as the spiritual truth. How many of us in here have had problems? And the problems and the trials and the tribulation weigh us down so heavy. You know, maybe it's the problems of the world. Maybe it's the things that are happening in our family. Maybe it's the thing that's happening in our wealth. Or, you know, maybe it's the thing that's happening in our health. Maybe it's the things that are grief and sorrow. And all of a sudden, this is what I think this physical picture shows. All of a sudden, spiritually, mentally, physically, we just get worn down. We become weird. We become burdened to the point that we're bent over with our problems, our trials, our tribulations. We have all these things in the world that are taking us. It looks like Hurricane Satan has attacked our lives, and we're just suffering because of it. And then there's the church. The church doesn't help a lot in these matters sometimes. Sometimes the church comes on, they tell you all kinds of crazy things. Just lay it at the altar. And you're thinking to yourself, do you know what my report is? How do I lay it at the altar and not get up and pick it up again? You know, sometimes I think church people aren't much different than they were 2,000 years ago. Because 2,000 years ago in this environment, people believed that the lady had this adversity. She had this burden. She had this because she was out of the will of God. You know, she had in some kind of sin, some way she wasn't obeying the law of God, and that's why God had made her suffer like this. And how many church times, sometimes you're going through something, they say, well, what are you doing wrong? If you would quit this, God would bless you. And church people, sometimes they just make the burden of your problems already worse. You got enough of guilt about some of the things that you got. And all of a sudden the church comes on and they heap more piles on you. And sometimes it's just simply sin, you know. Even good Christians sometimes get involved in sin. But if you've never come to Christ and you've never let him take that burden of sin off of you, and there's a lot of Christians that confess Christ. And there's a lot of Christians out there that confess Christ. And they never let Jesus take that sin burden off of them. They're still carrying around all that guilt and all that ugly stuff. So you've got that on top of it. And if you've never come to Christ, you still have all that stuff that you can't get rid of. And all of a sudden, you're so burdened by the things of the world, and you're burdened by your guilt, and you're burdened by others, and you're burdened by sin. You're burdened by sin. You're doubled over. You're bent over by all this. You're bent over physically, you're bent over mentally, and you're bent over spiritually. But Jesus, he just calls us forward. And he says, come to me. And when this lady came, when she made that decision, she walks past the embarrassment. She walks past, what are the others going to say about me? She walks past her pride. She walks past her pain. She walks past everything. She takes a chance. She walks right to the front, looks at her, and he says, woman, you are healed. And he touches her, and she stands up right. The burden, the guilt, the disease, it was all gone. Instantly, it was gone. And you know what the scripture says? You know what the author of this account says? He says, and she praised God for all that he had done. Now, is that somebody here today? Is that somebody today that's under such burden? Maybe you've done some... It's always a chance. Maybe you've done some things that you know you ought not have done and just never let Jesus take it away from you. You know, maybe people, even church people with good intentions have hurt you. Millions and millions and millions of people in our country, and just the burden of life. Just the burden of taking care of others. Just the burden of children. Just the problems of finances or at work. It's all just got you bent over and you're weary. How many of you may be going through something today? You don't have to raise your hand because all of us are, you know, Pastor told me one time there's only three types of people. Those that are getting ready to go into something, those that are going through something, and those that are just coming out of going through something. And that's all. We know. And so often, if you're like me, you just come up here and you lay it at the altar and you say, Lord, it's done. I give it to you. And as soon as you get up, you pick it back up and you carry it with you. And I'm telling you, I know this because I have tried to do it. And I always, sooner or later, usually sooner than later, pick it back up again. There are some problems in life that are just so big and so bad that you just can't leave them at the altar and walk away from them. I know. I know Jesus has promised me rest. And I've tried, Lord, but I don't understand. I've come to you, God, led to you. But I don't find this rest that you promised me. I bring it to the altar. I try not to worry about my circumstances. But no matter how hard I try, no matter how hard I tried, I just couldn't do it. I started going to church. I'd listen to sermons. I'd read my Bible. I would study. I'd read other books. No matter how hard I tried, there have been some problems in my life, I just couldn't leave at the altar. They were just too big. You know, when your health is in jeopardy, when that cup of water is too hard, when you just got a bad doctor's report, when your parents are sick, when your children are sick, when you're in the middle of finances and you don't know if you're going to lose everything you've worked your entire life for, you just can't say, I left it at the altar. I'm not going to worry about it. I mean, if it's your kids, you love your kids. You don't want to just say, leave it at the altar. When a loved one dies, or your house is in foreclosure, or your job is gone, and you don't have any money, even for the basic necessity, it's easy to say, I'm resting in the arms of Jesus, but my goodness, it is so difficult to live. And maybe if you're like me, you had somebody quote you read it in the Bible, you heard a sermon, like I have, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. I knew it. I could quote it. I heard it. I read it. I studied it. And I couldn't find the rest. I knew it. I knew Matthew 28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. But I didn't understand Matthew 29 and 30. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Is that easy and light yet? So let me tell you the story behind this. One day there was a lady in a seminar, and she's explaining how to handle the burdens of life. And she was teaching a stress management class. And she raises a glass like this, and everyone anticipated, maybe what you anticipated, you know, is it half empty or is it half full? Maybe that's what you thought when you walked in here today. But she fooled them. What she did is ask them, how much do you think this glass of water weighs? Price said it weighed about a pound or 2 pounds, right? Yeah. How much does it weigh right now?
A lot more than that.
Go ahead, sit down. See, here's the thing. Hey, everybody give Bryce a hand for helping me out today. Even though he didn't know her.
Boy,
there's
so late for that.
Here's what the teacher explained. And I do thank you, Bryce.
Yeah.
She said the absolute weight of the glass of water does not mean anything. It does not matter. What matters is how long you hold it. See, Bryce said this isn't heavy at all when he first picked it up. But the longer he held it, the heavier it began. You hold it for a minute, it's not a problem. You hold it for 5 minutes and your arm starts to hold. You hold it for 10 minutes and you have to start switching arms. You hold it for 20 minutes, you got to sit down and let it rest. I mean, I would imagine if you had told him to hold that cup for the whole day, we'd have to call an ambulance. See, each case, the weight of the glass was exactly the same. The longer he held on to it, the heavier it became. Let me tell you something. That's how it is with our burdens. They're light in the beginning. Something happens and we get a little fearful and we hope it goes up. But when it goes on for days or months or even years, the longer we hold on to it, the longer we carry it, the heavier it becomes, doesn't it? Just like that glass of water. It's not that hard in the beginning. You know, we took care of my wife's father for about 3 years before he passed away. He passed away right at our house. First couple months was easy. You know, he was joyful. We had taken the hospital about once a month because he had heart attacks about 10, 12 times a year. Had a really terrible heart. His wife had passed away. The first couple months wasn't hard at all. 6 months into it, it got a little harder. A year later, it was getting really hard. By the time 3 years was up, you hate to say this, but you were almost so overburdened. You were so tired. You were so weary. All you're looking for is a way to escape. The longer we held on to that burden, the heavier it becomes. So that's the way it is when we carry our problems around. The longer we carry them, the heavier they become. And if we carry that burden long enough, we have to do what Bryce did, and we have to just set it down for a while. And we got to rest. Because if we keep carrying around, it's going to destroy us. We're already bent over double. But if we don't set it down, we're just going to collapse under the weight. Now, I know, and I talk to people every day that are going through difficult trials. And some of the people that I talk to have been going through them for years, and I wonder how they would keep that up. You know, sometimes Bryce put that down for a little while, and he'd rest, and he could pick it up, or he'd switch hands, and then he could switch it back to the other hand. He would rest for a while, but then he could pick it up for a while. That's the way it is with our problems. Sometimes we got to just set them down for a while. We got to rest. And then when we do, we can pick them up. Jan and I, we got in a habit about every 6 months of taking about a 3-day vacation. We couldn't take much longer than that, but we would go somewhere, even if it was a tent in the middle of the woods, for 3 days, just to rest. And you refresh, and you come back, and you carry it for a little bit longer, and then the weight starts getting to you again, and then you gotta do it again. Whatever your burden is, the heavier it becomes depends on how long you carry it. And sometimes when you have the world's problems upon you, and then you have your guilt from the stuff that you used to do you hadn't been able to get rid of, and then people come along, the church and well-intended employees and friends, and they dump more guilt on you, and then you have your sin, whatever it is, and you're carrying all that junk around, you just get so weighted down that you just want to sit back and relax And then you pick it back up again, and you rest it, and you can carry it on a little longer. Whatever it is that's making you weary and burn, that's bending and double, you just set it down for a while. And then you can pick it back up, and you can go forward for a little bit longer. Life is short. We need to learn to rest more. I mean, that's good advice. But you know, when we do that in our own power, when we continue to rest in our own power, we're still trying to have control, aren't we? We still have control. We're still trying to determine our own destiny. We're not resting in the rest Jesus came to give us. We're not resting in the rest he promised us. We're just getting a little bit of physical rest, and we're still trying to do it in our own power. We're still trying to decide where we're going to go, what we're going to do. It's all about us. And you can do it on your own power for a while. And if you've never let Jesus, you know, be Lord over your life, you know as well as I do, you can do it for a while, but you can't do it forever. It works for a little while, but sooner or later, it's going to get heavy again. You got to drop it again, and you got to try to wait to pick it up until you've got some rest. Or you can do what most Christians do. I mean, Christians are famous for this. Come to the altar and just leave it here, and then we leave it there, and we go away and we pretend to our friends and everybody in the congregation that everything's great. And you know, and I know, and everybody else really knows, everything's not great. You pick those burdens back up again, you carry them for a while, and then you come back to the altar and you drop them again. And you get tired again, you go back laying down again. And it's just a vicious, vicious cycle. You do it over and over again. See, the secret to finding rest is not in Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. Yes, that is a great part of it. That's not the entire thing. Yes, we do need to come to Jesus to get his rest, but the secret is not in 11:28. The secret is in 11:29 and 30. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. See, the first thing you see is Jesus says, yeah, take my yoke. And that sound, it's almost cliche. It sounds so easy. Jesus gives us this wonderful invitation. But not only does he invite us. I mean, this is one of the greatest invitations in all of Scripture. I mean, when you listen to this statement by Jesus, you find that this is one of the most beautiful invitations from God in all of Scriptures. Come to me. If you're tired and you're weary, come to me. If you're burdened, come to me, and I will rest. Of course we need to come to Jesus. Jesus said, you have to take my yoke and place it upon you. See, he not only invites us, that's wonderful, he invites us, but he requires something from us. He encourages. He almost demands that we participate in it. He says, in this invitation, I'm going to ask you to come. I'm not going to force you to come. I'm going to ask you to come. Just come to me and learn from me. We have to participate. We have to go to him. And we have to be willing to learn from him. You know, one of the first things that as you read Scripture, you find out is anytime Jesus had to make a decision, or anytime Jesus had a problem, he prayed. You see Jesus praying on mountainside. You see Jesus getting prayed up early in the morning. You see Jesus praying with the disciples. You see Jesus praying alone. You see Jesus praying with the crowds. Jesus was in constant prayer with his Father. Luke 18, he tells his disciples this story, this parable about a woman who was desperate, and she was persistent, and she continued and continued and continued. And he says, the way it is with you. Be persistent in your prayers. Don't give up on your prayers. You think God's done? I know, and you know. Guy whose wife prayed for him for over 50 years to come to Christ, and at 79 and a half, he finally accepted Jesus. She was persistent. She never gave up. The bigger the decision, the more important it was. The bigger the problem, the more Jesus prayed. The night before he picked his 12 disciples, you may not know this, he started praying on a mountainside, and he prayed all the way through the night and into the morning, never slept, and then went and said, here's the 12 disciples that I picked. When he was about to go to the cross, the people who saw him afterwards said he was praying so hard, it looked like he was sweating blood. Bigger the problem was, the harder he prayed. The bigger the problem was, the more he prayed. I mean, that's a lesson that we can learn from Jesus. But Jesus just didn't pray for deliverance. He prayed, my Father, it is not possible for this cup to be taken away from me. God, I'm sure Bryce was probably praying the same thing a few minutes ago. Is this not possible for this cup to be taken away from me unless I drink of it? No. May your will be done regardless. It doesn't matter. I'm going to be obedient no matter what you say. Jesus prayed a prayer of surrender. He prayed a prayer of obedience. See, here's the thing. When we say we want to take our problem to the cross and leave them there, what we usually think is, hey, I'm going to get rid of my problem. There's not going to be any more problems. I don't have to worry about it anymore. I'm going to get a break. I'm going to get a vacation from all my problems. I'm not going to have any more problems. I'm going to take them, my concerns, my problems, my worries to God, and I'm going to give them to Him, and I don't have to worry about it anymore. I have no more responsibility over them. See, Jesus, He doesn't say that. He says, that's not how you get true rest. He never promises throughout the Scriptures we won't have problems. In fact, He promises us the exact opposite. In this world, you will have troubles. Not maybe, not could be. You will have troubles. What He says is, you come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. You take my yoke upon you and learn from me, because I'm gentle and I'm humble in heart, and I will find rest, not just for your bodies, but all the way deep down into your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So you have to bring your burdens to Jesus. That's clear. That's evident. We have to participate. We bring them to the cross, but you don't rest by just leaving them there. There's some burdens you can't walk away from. There's some problems that are so big you cannot get out of them. Yeah, we come to Jesus, but He's not talking about just giving Him the problem. What He's talking about is, you read this, He's talking about full surrender. He's talking about surrendering your will to His will. We rest by yoking ourselves with Jesus and doing exactly what He wants us to do. We still have to do the work. If you understand a yoke, when you're placed in that yoke, you lose control. A farm animal is free running around the farm until he's put into the yoke. Once he's in the yoke, he has to go where the master tells him to go. A yoke is for the purpose of doing work. A yoke is still a yoke. He said, put my yoke on. A yoke is still a yoke. A yoke is confining. A yoke is constraining. A yoke is a symbol of label and service and authority. But understand this. It's the one that you're yoked to that determines if that burden, that labor, what you're carrying is heavy and burdensome or light and easy. See, when you get yoked to Jesus, you no longer have the choice to go in whatever direction you want. You have to go in His direction. But Jesus says, hey, you're yoked to me, but my yoke is easy and light because I am gentle and humble in heart. So not only will you find rest for your body, I'll give you rest so deep it's good for your soul. You know, we lay that glass of water down and we rest for a while and then we pick it back up. And when we do that without yoking ourselves to Jesus, we can still go on any path we want. We can do whatever we want to do. But when we come to Jesus and we surrender to Him and we yoke ourselves to Him, we're choosing to yoke ourselves on a path that we don't have a choice about anymore. We're choosing to let Jesus guide us, to let Jesus lead us, because we're yoked to Him. We have to go where He tells us to go. Jesus says, if you want rest, you need to surrender. Those who are weary and burdened, come to me, but don't look for a way out. Look to be yoked to me. And He says, I'll tell you something, it's not a bad deal, because my yoke is easy and my yoke is light. But a yoke is still a yoke. You're still connected to me. You still have to go where I tell you to go. You're not going to be able to make your decisions on your own any longer. You're going to have to listen to my still small voice. You may be led down some pathways that you don't necessarily want to go on. But I'm going to tell you, it's going to be all right because you're connected to me. Jesus invites us, come all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Here's the thing, we have, just like that lady in the bent over woman, we have a choice to make. We have to make the choice to decide to come to Jesus, just as that woman did, had to choose and come to Jesus. When he calls, we have a response. He says, come to me, and we voluntarily surrender our will to his will by connecting ourselves, by yoking ourselves to him. But when we do, Jesus promises this, you will learn from it. Not just a matter of going anywhere Jesus takes you, it's about learning from him as well. He says, your character is going to become like my character. When you're yoked with Jesus, you're going to become closer to him than you ever have before. You're side by side in the walk. When you become yoked with Jesus, you can begin to enjoy your journey. You can begin to find rest because Jesus is taking the lead in your life. And you're learning from him and in him because you're in his yoke and he's right there beside you. There was a couple. The man's name was Ken. I never did get the woman's name, so I'm just going to call her Barbie. So it's Ken Barbie.
There you go.
Some of you had kids. I know that right now.
That's right.
And over the fireplace in Ken and Barbie's house was this yoke. Now, the yoke didn't match any of the other decor in the house. It didn't match anything at all in the house, but Ken and Barbie, they didn't really care. It's an old-fashioned, hand-hewn oak. It's made out of wood. It's been a family heirloom forever. Now, Barbie's father, and I don't know his name either, so we'll just call him Mattel. He was from Germany or something. I'm not sure. And Mattel would yoke his oxen to the yoke to haul coal. That's how they heated their house. And even though the yoke didn't go very well with the house, Ken and Barbie kept it there because it was just this wonderful treasure, family heirloom, but it was an object lesson. She said, come to me, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And when you look at this yoke hanging on the wall, man, it doesn't look light or easy, does it? It's a heavy piece of wood with two wooden straps that go around your neck. That doesn't look light, it doesn't look easy. But the fact is, when you put animals in there together, they can do what one cannot do. They can pull the load. Guess where the load is? It's behind them now. The yoke is actually makes the work easy. And I want you to notice something. On this yoke, one side's bigger than the other. Now, I studied a lot of yokes. Almost every single one of them, especially one that you could tell was handmade, you know, one side was always bigger than the other. And I didn't understand that, so I started doing some research. And what I found out is the larger one was for the larger animal who was stronger and better trained. He was bigger, he was stronger, and he was already trained. He was experienced. The smaller yoke was for a smaller animal, one that wasn't trained, one that was weaker. And they would yoke the two together so that the smaller animal would become stronger and would learn from the more experienced animal. Now, when you're in a yoke with Jesus, which side do you think you're on? See, I don't know about you. Maybe you're more spiritual than me, but the fact is, burdens are a fact of life. And we have a choice. We can drag our workload under our own strength, or we can put on the yoke of Jesus and let him help us. We can try to make our own path, or we can follow Jesus. She says, come, if you're weary and you're burdened, I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke, learn from me. Jesus says, I'm gentle, I'm humble in heart. I may not take your burdens away, but I'll help you carry them, and I'll teach you how to make them lighter as you do carry them. He says, if you come to me, you'll find the best kind of rest, not just rest for your bodies, but rest that goes all the way down to your soul. Peaceful, deep, sweet rest. Even in the midst of your burdens. You know, so often I would bring my burdens to the altar, and I would leave them there, or so I thought. There were times that I was in a big church one time, and when you came to the altar, everybody rejoiced. But I would pick them up almost as soon as I got out of that altar. I'd carry them around again, and then a month later, I'm back trying to lay them down again. And I just couldn't figure out how to get this rest Jesus promised me. There's some burdens that were just too heavy. They needed to be dealt with, and I couldn't leave them at the cross, and I couldn't ignore them. Now, I remember one time I was sitting on a couch with my wife. And all of a sudden she says, "Rob, I'm not feeling good." And she sort of falls over. She goes, "I don't have much feeling right here. Is that, everything look okay?" Well, I didn't want to scare her. When I looked at her, she had one pupil about the size of the end of this pencil and the other pupil this size. And half her body wasn't working. It scared me to death. We ran to the emergency room. We get her in the emergency room. They keep her in there 3 or 4 days in what they call the stroke ward. And she's not getting any better. We take her up to John Hopkins. We're in church one day, and the service is just about over, and she just collapses. She has absolutely no feeling. It's, you know, they're treating her for a stroke, and we don't know what's going on. And I'm telling you, it's a burden. It took a year to get her diagnosed. And she was actually diagnosed with a migraine, and believe it or not. It was a what they call a biarterial migraine. Most migraines, the blood vessels in the head shrink, you get a headache. But with hers, she lost, and it was on the right side sometimes and the left side sometimes. It was terrible. About the same time, Taylor, my oldest daughter, my daughter will be 20 in January next month, she's diagnosed with heart problems. You know, she has multiple holes in her heart, and her heart's getting out of whack, and it's scary. And you know, then from there, we find out she had what they call POTS, which is an autoimmune disease. And then we find out she's got a blood disease, she's got a hematologist, she probably needs a psychologist too, a cardiologist, neurologist, because the POTS is actually a neurological disease. At the same time, I got a younger daughter, and her ears are so bad, pus would just rip down her face, and we couldn't get it under control no matter how many antibiotics. She still got hearing problems, finally got tubes in her ear, but the tubes kept coming out because the problems were so bad. I was facing health problems. They thought I was having heart attacks. They couldn't tell 3 or 4 months in the hospital, and they just couldn't ever find out what it was. Possibly a heart attack, possibly not. So I got my wife. At the same time, I just bought my partner out, and our landlords had filed bankruptcy for sale sign. So I've got all this extra debt. My sales will be cut in half. We're facing foreclosure in the business, facing foreclosure in the house, and we don't even know how the money's coming in for the next meal. And you got all that going on at one time in your life. I'm telling you, you just can't go to the cross and say, "Hey, I'm going to leave it here, and I'm going to walk away." I mean, I'd go to church, and I'd hear these messages. "Come lay it at the cross. You know, all you are a burden and weary, come and lay it at the cross, and I'll give you rest." And I'd lay it up there, and I'd go to the altar, and I'd lay my burdens down, and I'd put on my happy face. And I'd walk out like everything was okay, and deep down, I knew that everything wasn't okay. You know, I tried to lay it down, but all my kids are sick. Chelsea, my oldest daughter, she's got lupus. Now, one time we go to the hospital with her, it's funny now, it wasn't funny then. But if you knew Chelsea and you walked in and you didn't know it was her, you did not recognize her. Her face rolled up, and her eyes got real. She looked like a jack-o'-lantern. I swear, we put a candle in her mouth, she'd have lit up. But it was lupus. It was bad. So you try to lay all that down, and all your kids are sick, your house is not, your bills aren't being paid, your business is in trouble, your health is bad, your wife's health is bad. It's hard to rest. It wasn't until I learned the secret. Take yoke with Jesus, go in His way. It didn't mean I didn't have any more burdens. I still had all that stuff going on. It didn't mean I didn't even have any more worry. You can't help but worry about your kid. But it was that I found out that if I were led ahead, I could learn from Jesus and He would help me carry those burdens. But in order to do that, I had to do some things myself. I had to come to Jesus. I had to read His word. I had to stand on His promises. I had to believe what I couldn't see. He'd say, "It's going to be all right, Rob." And I'm like, "Okay, which one of these is going to be all right?" "It's all going to be all right. We got too many problems, God. It can't be all right. It's all going to be all right." And I learned to trust Him through the most difficult times. Not because I'm more spiritual, but because I had no choice. But the day I decided to let Him carry that weight and not me, it got easier. Because His burden was light. He helped me carry it. And He was teaching me for things that were going to get worse. He was making me stronger so I could handle bigger problems. But you know what? When you're yoked to Jesus, a yoke is still a yoke. I'm tied to Jesus. He helped me carry the load. He teach me to be like Him so I could find rest for my soul. but I had to go in his direction. I could no longer go in my direction. I couldn't do the things I used to do to relieve me of the stress. I had to rely on him. I'd rely on the one who is gentle and humble in heart. And then I could begin to find rest for my soul. I'll tell you a story. And I love this story because it makes so much sense to me. There was a new pastor, and he's walking with a more older, experienced pastor. And they're sort of walking through a rose garden. And this new pastor is overwhelmed. And I understand this. He's overwhelmed with his new responsibilities. He has all the things that are in his life that are still burdened down. But now he has a congregation, and this congregation has some real and some big problems, and he's overwhelmed. You know, is this really the calling on my life? You know, I'm young. I have some problems at home. I have some problems here. And now I've got a whole congregation of people. I've got to deal with those problems as well. And the older pastor is just walking, and he's listening to him. And this guy has great respect for this pastor. So the older pastor, he walks up to a rose bush, and he just picks off a rose bud like this, and he hands it to the younger pastor. And he said, I want you to unfold this rose and never break a leaf off. Never damage a leaf. Now the pastor, the younger pastor, he's thinking to himself, this is so crazy. What does this have to do with, making my burden lighter, making my responsibilities lighter? What does this have to do with God's will for my life? But he has such great respect for this pastor, he decides to go ahead and try anyway. So as he begins to unfold this rose, he finds out that he can't do it. It's an impossible task. He tries to unfold, the leaf breaks off. He tries to be gentle, but the leaf gets bruised. He's trying to figure it out, and he knows he can't do it, but he's got respect for this pastor, so he begins to do it anyway. So the older pastor, seeing that the younger pastor was starting to struggle and saw the impossibility of being able to open this rose up without tearing it, he begins to quote this point. Listen to the words of it. It is only a tiny rosebud, a flower of God's design, but I cannot unfold the petals with these clumsy hands of mine. The secret of unfolding flowers is not known to such as I. God opens this flower so easily, but in my hands they die. If I cannot unfold a rosebud, this flower of God's design, then how can I have the wisdom to unfold this life of mine? So I must come and lay down my request and say, not my will, but thine. So I'll trust in God for leading each moment of my day. I will look to God for guidance in each step of the way. I am weary and heavy burdened, so in his yoke I'll stay. The path that lies before me, only my Lord knows. I will find the rest for my soul, as the scripture goes. I'll trust God to unfold the moments, just as he unfolds the rose. See, sometimes our problems get so big, it's like trying to unfold a rosebud. Can't be done in our own strength. And we grow weary trying to do what only God can do. We have all these problems. Sometimes we continue to hold on to them and they become sober. We feel like we're bent over from all their weight. Tragedy, sorrow, disappointment, depression, grief, the guilt of our past, the guilt that others put on us, the guilt that we put us on ourselves, this sin that we just can't be able to shake. All this visits everybody's household sooner or later. And Jesus invites each one of us to come to him. The invitation is personal. He drives no one away. Come to me. It's for everybody. He calls us individually to himself. The invitation is present. Come now and do not wait. The invitation is so great and so good, it demands a spontaneous response and an immediate acceptance. And the invitation is exclusive. Come to me and to no one else. Come to me and do nothing else. Put on the yoke of Jesus and become united in it. It's because that's what a yoke does. It puts the two together as one. The stronger, the more experienced one is teaching the younger and less experienced. The weaker one is learning from the stronger one. Jesus offers us to be united with him so that we can be in fellowship with him and learning to rest, not in our rest, but in his rest, the rest that only he can give us, a rest that's so deep it travels down to your soul. See, as you read scriptures, one of the things you'll never hear Jesus say, he'll never tell you, let me teach you how to be stressed out. Let me teach you how to be troubled. Let me teach you how to be burdened. So you don't have to teach somebody to do something which comes natural. We have to be taught how to be in his rest. We can have some rest on our own. We can't have his rest without him. We have to have rest for our soul. Especially rest so deep that you can have peace even in the midst of your trouble. It's a great invitation. It's personal. He tells you to come. The invitation demands a response. Come to me and surrender. Take my yoke and learn from me. And if you do, I'll give you rest. The invitation is present. Come to me now and don't wait. So I'm going to ask Bryce to come up and ask him to play a song, What We Have a Friend in Jesus. And as he comes up here and he begins to play, I'm just going to open the altars up and invite you to come to Jesus, all you who are weary and burdened. And see if Jesus will give you rest for your soul as he promised. You know, I know what it's like. The time in my life when my burdens had me doubled over and bent over. And I don't know whether any of you feel that today. I don't know if you feel like you're that bent over woman, you can't stand up at all. The pain, the shame has weighed you down, and you feel like you just can't even stand up straight. Sometimes it feels like you have so many problems that Hurricane Satan has just ripped all your life apart and it's been unleashed. Some of us, you know, maybe it's the disease of sin. You just can't seem to overcome it. There don't seem to be any way out. You think to yourself, how long have you been holding on to that? How long have you been carrying it? The question is, isn't it just time to give it to Jesus? As Bryce goes back, let me just say, come to Jesus, all you who are weary and burdened. Take his yoke and learn from him, for he is gentle and meek. And you will find rest for your soul. Let Jesus carry whatever you're going through. And it's a great time to respond to his invitation. Don't let embarrassment or arrogance or pride stop you from coming forward. You feel like you're doubled over, can't stand up straight. I'm going to open the altars up as Bryce sings.
To God.
about 6 to go to the concert. I've had the privilege of seeing Bishop twice on TV. Children and grandchildren think Christianity is boring.